Okay, this is chapter 42, musculoskeletal function. This is going to kind of like be a short introduction, okay, to the muscle skeletal system. And then in following lectures, we're going to get into to more disease, health issues, trauma, things like that. Generally, you know that the movement, framework, protection of the body shape, calcium storage, and much more is the major overall purpose of the skeletal system, okay? In the system, of course, we have cartilage. Different types of cartilage, you know. We have hyaline cartilage, elastic cartilage, and then fibrocartilage. Cartilage, in general, is firm but very flexible, okay? And here you can read about, you know, the different cells involved in cartilage, okay? And right up above it, you've got different skeletal breakups, divisions that you can read about the skeleton. I would say look at the key here, the skeletal system, on page 1082, okay? So, but back to cartilage. We have our hyaline cartilage that forms the costal cartilage. It joins ribs basically to the sternum. The elastic cartilage, dense network of elastic fibers, flexible. We see it in the auricle, the external ear. The fibro, okay, it's a dense connective tissue cartilage. It's present in the intervertebral disc and in the menisci of the knee. This type of cartilage, this one here, is of course the one that is injured in a lot of sports injuries, where they make sharp foot plants and then a very sharp turn, basketball, football, even hockey, you know, in sports like that. Now, so, hyaline, elastic, fibro. Cartilage, like I said, firm but flexible. Now, it does get injured. Anything goes past the point of stress, it's going to be injured. I got a little section here on repair of hyaline cartilage. It can tolerate considerable amount of intense stress and repetitive stress, but once in a while there will be damage happen. Now, this cartilage, the hyaline cartilage, in its repair process, it's subject to calcification. Now, follow this a little bit. This cartilage forms the costal cartilage. It joins ribs to sternum, okay? Now, in the repair, it is subject to calcification. Now, follow that another step. What could this possibly do to someone's breathing? What could this do to their inspiratory effort? What could this do to their expiratory effort? If the flexible tissue gets calcified, well, you could just follow it out, how it's going to get stiff, and respiratory effort, inspiration, expiration could greatly change. The bones and structures, you can read about the different types of bones here. I've got a few listed, the spongy light bone, the compact bone. Bones are basically classified by shape. Some bones are long, some are short, some are flat, and some are irregular. Okay, now as you're studying these, look and see where in the body are the long bones. Where in the body are the short, what bones make up the flat bones, and which bones are considered the irregular bones. Where are these bones in the body? Now, and also, what is the purpose that they serve? What is their job? What is the function of these different, you know, four classifications of bones. So be looking at figure 42-2. Now, other parts of the bone, the periosteum and the endosteum, okay? The periosteum is, you know, bones are covered by a membrane, and this membrane is called the periosteum. Now, when a bone fractures, the periosteum, the membrane, of course, tears. And this is one of the reasons why pain with a fractured bone. The endosteum, okay, the endosteum, what it does is it lines the spaces of the spongy bone. Now, the endosteum is composed of osteogenic cells. Look that up. You know, what are osteogenic cells? What's their purpose? What is their function? How do they work? What is their benefit to the body? So, like I said, the periosteum covers the bones, membranes, and the endosteum is what lines inside the bones in the spongy space. So, as you read through your book, read about the bone marrow. And, of course, we've talked about this before, development of blood, you know, and the formation of blood. Approximately, for most of us, it's about every 21 days is where we make new blood, mostly in the hips and the sternum. So you can expect people that have issues with their hips or issues with their sternum because of the decreased blood production. You can just follow that to all the issues that those folks could basically have. Now, as far as bone tissue, we have laminar and woven bone. The laminar are the strong, highly organized bone, where the woven are a low tensile strength bone. The bone cells, you know, okay, osteoblast. Osteoblasts are these bone-building cells, and what they do is they secrete a bone matrix. They're responsible for calcification of the bone matrix. This won't be in any of your tests or anything like this, but if you got some extra time, this might be interesting to read about. It was a surgery quite a few years ago. It was called the Lizaroth surgery, and the doctor was from Russia, of course. Name was Dr. Lizaroth. It was named after him. Okay, trying to explain it without using my hands and stuff is kind of tough. But virtually what the person did was they had like an erector set on the outside of their leg. Now, what this was for were people that were 3 or 4 inches, one leg was 3 or 4 inches shorter than the other. It was a leg lengthening procedure. When a bone breaks, okay, the osteoblast, the bone cells, you know, this is their job, okay, to knit the bone back together, to fit it back together. Actually, a lot of times where a bone breaks becomes the strongest point in the entire bone because it's got the newest osteoblast, you know. So anyways, like I said, they have wires through their leg, and it looks like an erector set. And this takes months and months. But what they'll basically do is the leg will be constantly being separated at the point of break, okay? So what happens is where the surgical break was made, the bone is never allowed to be stationary and set and heal and knit together. It's constantly being separated, very minutely, of course. I mean, my goodness, the separation is extremely minimal. But they keep on doing this for months and even up to a year. If everything works the way is hoped, that surgical break will continue to fill with osteoblasts. And after many months, the person could have a leg that was equal in size to the other leg, and then no longer have a leg that's 3 or 4 inches short, which you can imagine if somebody has that, one leg shorter than the other, okay? You know, the pressure on the vertebrae in the back, which of course could eventually cause spinal injury. The curvature there will cause interthoracic pressures. The hip pain with the shorter leg enduring more of the hip pressure, you know, the hip pain that these people could have. It takes quite a bit of dedication to do this surgery and to be willing to go through this process. But for the person that does, a lot of times the benefits are really positive for them. But just look that up. It's just kind of interesting. Now, as far as bone formation and growth, bone cell in children, you know, you've heard about scurvy. You know, the vitamin C deficiency in what can basically happen. We have growth plates, you know, the different plates here, the different section of the grooves, the epiphyseal plate. You know, read about the growth of a bone in children. Children, while they sleep, mostly grow. This is when children grow, when they sleep. So if there are bone issues and a bone growth regulation, especially due to scurvy, you can imagine the young one is not going to grow. So read about what impairs this function of bone growth. Read about what causes slow growth of the different plates, or could actually cause a cessation or a bone to basically grow, the stopping of a bone to basically stop growing. And there's your word I want you to look up. Joints, you know, review about your joints, the different synovial joints, the ligaments and tendons that are in the joint, how joints and these ligaments, you know, and the tendons there, a lot of times these tendons will tear rather than stretch. And of course, when that happens, pain. Joints, you know, read about the bursa, read about the tendon sheath, you know, and we'll be talking, of course, more about arthritis and the different types of arthritis. The lot of ones that a lot of people suffer from is the wear and tear arthritis, and we'll be talking more about that. So like I said, this was basically an introduction as we talked about cartilage, the hyaline elastic and fibro. The cartilage is firm but flexible. It's needed. Now, one of the things about cartilage, when we talked about the four types of bone, long, short, flat, irregular, cartilage is needed. Cartilage is needed, you know, for the growth and development of long bones. And as you're looking up, you know, where the long bones are at, you can imagine what it's going to be like if a person did not have, you know, that cartilage support, and that, you know, the long bones were not doing their job. The periosteum, endosteum, the different, the one is the covering of the bone, and of course the other is what lines the bones, spongy bone, the spaces of the spongy bone. The blood supply, the osteoblast, the bone cells, and their job of the bone building cells that secrete bone matrix that's responsible for calcification. Some of the bone formation growth issues, of course, especially with children, is scurvy, the vitamin C deficiency. And in study about in children, you know, what causes a slow growth of the epiphyseal plate? And what can cause a whole sensation of bone growth, you know, as related to a young child? So that is where we will end for chapter 42. Bye now.